Thank you everyone for being here. Welcome, and welcome to everyone who's watching on the live stream. I'm really glad you could be here today, because I'm really excited to share this piece of music with all of you. It's not performed very much, because of its length and difficulty, and there's even a pretty good chance it's never been performed here at the University of Iowa before. So, this is a lecture recital, but because this piece is already 50 minutes long, that's 5-0, I am going to do us all a favor and keep the talking short. It's also a piece that helps, it's more enjoyable to listen to if you have some explanation, and the composer thought so too, I'll tell you in a second. So what I'm going to do is, before each of the four movements, I'll talk for just a few minutes about what you'll be hearing in that movement, because otherwise it would be a lot to keep track of over the course of the whole thing. So this is the Concord Sonata by American composer Charles Ives. He was born in the 1870s and lived until the 1950s. He's from New England. He was also a successful insurance executive and co-founded a major insurance company. His music was not very popular during most of his lifetime, and that was hard for him. So he wrote this piece and titled it, subtitled it, the long title, as you can see on your program, is Concord, Massachusetts, 1840 to 1860. That's a period of time leading up to the American Civil War, when a school of philosophy called Transcendentalism was happening in New England, around the city of Concord, Massachusetts, near Boston. Each of the four movements in this piece is named after one of four writers, American writers who lived and worked around Concord during that time period, and they were all associated with Transcendentalism in some way. The first movement is called Emerson, after Ralph Waldo Emerson. He was a philosopher and an essayist, and he was the founder of the Transcendentalist movement. A couple of notable things about Transcendentalism. Emerson and the others believed that human beings were basically good, or inherently good, that nature and humanity are both sort of like expressions of the divine or of God, and are therefore all linked, are all one. And he believed that humanity was sort of on this path towards unity with each other and with the divine, and that that was sort of inevitable despite, you know, the mess that the world is at times. One other feature, let's see. I don't know. So I'll leave you with a quote from Emerson. Charles Ives talking about Emerson. In this first movement, Emerson's writings were known to be dense, a little bit hard to get through. Like, he had very interesting ideas, but didn't always bother putting them clearly on paper. So Charles Ives took it on himself to try to recreate that in musical form. So you're gonna hear dense, overlapping, complicated ideas kind of all jumbled on top of each other. The opening 30 seconds will give you a pretty good idea. That's interspersed with lighter, more clear moments. There's even a stretch towards the middle of this movement that's supposed to be some of Emerson's poetry. So you'll hear something a little more lyrical and a little more measured. Finally, Ives sprinkles this movement with quotes of Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, the famous opening that you probably all know. And that basic motive is like permeates this movement, along with one other kind of musical clue for you to grab onto. There's a tune that Ives made up that he uses throughout this entire piece. It's sometimes nicknamed the human faith theme, and it sounds like this. It has a Beethoven's Fifth quote in it. Beethoven's fifth motive, and he's referencing the fact that sometimes people like to say that it sounds like fate knocking at the door. Maybe you've heard that. Here's what Ives says. There's an oracle at the beginning of the fifth symphony. In those four notes lies one of Beethoven's greatest messages. He says, we, referring to himself, would place its translation above the relentlessness of fate knocking at the door, above the greater human message of destiny, and strive to bring it towards the spiritual message of Emerson's revelations, even to the common heart of Concord, the soul of humanity knocking at the door of the divine mysteries, radiant in the faith that it will be opened and that the human will become the divine.
Thank you.
congratulations, we all made it through the first movement. It is the longest and it's the most intense. The next three are a little bit more crowd friendly. That first one, you know, is sort of like ideas about the universe and humanity and a philosopher who's famously hard to read, you know, in musical form. So that's what that movement is. This next one is a major change of pace. This is Hawthorne, after Nathaniel Hawthorne, who many of you might have read The Scarlet Letter in high school or something. That's one of his most famous works. He also has a number of short stories. Ives says about, and he was not strictly a transcendentalist. He didn't completely buy it, but he was still part of that circle. Ives says about Hawthorne that essentially if you were to try to kind of in an abstract way sum up Hawthorne's ideas the way that he attempted to with Emerson, then the music would probably be about guilt and its effects on human conscience, since that's sort of a theme of Hawthorne. But he says instead, I didn't do that. And he uses the opportunity to explore like what he calls a lighter side of Hawthorne. In a lot of Hawthorne's short stories, there's magical or fantastical elements, things that aren't quite explainable through day-to-day things. And so what the second movement is a scherzo, a sort of, scherzo means musical joke, a bunch of different ideas running around after each other with very little warning. And this is the most picturesque or programmatic movement. It is almost everything you hear is painting some scene or story from Hawthorne. And I cannot give you a play-by-play of the entire movement. I'm not sure anyone knows exactly what's happening at every point, but there's a few things that we can pick up from Ives's writing about this. So at the very beginning, you'll hear some sort of feathery arpeggios that are supposed to be like frost patterns spreading on an enchanted hall window. A little bit later on, you have a really brief glimpse of a train. It's the Celestial Railroad. It's, Hawthorne has a short story that's kind of a satire on the Pilgrim's Progress, where instead of, you know, hiking to the Celestial City, passengers just get on a Celestial Railroad. So there's that. There's some other stuff. You'll hear one section that actually no one really knows exactly what in Hawthorne it comes from, but you'll know it's happening because I will use my block of wood. It's actually a very quiet and beautiful section, sort of a nocturne-like, and a nice break from most of the rest of the movement. Couple more things. You'll hear ragtime popping up here and there, and it kind of comes back with a vengeance about two-thirds of the way through. When I was writing this, it was the 19-teens mostly, and that was like the style of popular music in America at the time. You'll also hear another part where there is what my three-year-old daughter would call total pandemonium, like more than usual. And it's just total chaos, then suddenly it melts away and there's these quiet kind of organ-like chords playing that sound like a hymn. And that is a specific story, so you don't think it's more serious than it is. It is a Hawthorne story about a ghost that haunts a churchyard and protects the people inside from secular sounds. And at the same time, there is a circus parade coming down Main Street. So you hear the circus parade. They're not professional players, so it's a little chaotic. Then suddenly it stops, and the ghostly hymn is playing, and it gets interrupted again by the circus band, goes back to the hymn. Finally, the circus band wins out, and it goes into a full-on, like, wind band march. It just goes for a little bit. Then we go into more ragtime. Then finally, at the end, there's this passage that, again, no one really knows what it is. It's sometimes called the blizzard section, because it just sort of is a blizzard of notes for a while, and it's a lot of fun.
Thank you. Thank you.
named Alcotts, after Louisa May Alcott and her dad, Bronson Alcott. Louisa May Alcott is the author of Little Women and a number of other famous books. Her father, I believe, wrote some, but was mostly known for talking. And he was really good at having conversations. So they would have people like Ralph Waldo Emerson and Thoreau over to their house called the Orchard House. And I believe you can still go see it in Concord, Massachusetts. If you saw any of the recital flyers for this concert, there's an overlay of the Orchard House. You've actually already seen it. If you have ever seen or read Little Women in any of its many adaptations, it continues to be popular. There's movies, a recent one, there's a musical. Then you have some idea of what this movement is about, and even the whole piece, because transcendentalism and Boston / Concord and the scenery around the area all kind of made their way into Louisa May Alcott's writing. It's pretty autobiographical. Ives went to Concord and kind of wandered around, and this movement is his musical impression of being at Orchard House, something like 50, 60 years later, and he kind of imagines like the spirit of transcendentalism, almost like this ghostly overtone hanging around the house, so we can hear some of them, these kind of distant memories. And you'll hear a lot more simplicity in this movement compared to the others. He evokes Beth, who is one of the characters in Little Women. She's the one who is sick, playing at the piano and trying to pick out hymns and Scotch songs that apparently the Alcotts would sing around the piano. She would try to play Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. You'll hear some of that as well. And again, this is just his impression of the Orchard House.
Thank you.
fourth movement is called Thoreau, after Henry David Thoreau, who is most famously the author of Walden, where he chronicles his time living out by Walden Pond, alone in nature for 2 years. Thoreau was part of the same circle. He was friends with Ralph Waldo Emerson, and in fact, Emerson owned the land that Thoreau built his cabin on. And so he was influenced a lot by Emerson's ideas of nature being of like supreme importance. It's in connecting with nature that we can connect with ourselves and with each other in this sort of path towards the divine. So Thoreau decided to try it out, and he built this cottage himself, or this little cabin himself, out by Walden Pond. You can go visit the site today, and lived there for 2 years and wrote Walden. And so it's sort of a part diary of just the kind of mundane day-to-day things he did, partly poetic descriptions of nature, and then partly philosophy and reflecting on being self-reliant, living outside of society with all the pressure that we all feel day-to-day. So I chose to end the piece this way instead of with the previous movement, which could have ended it. This is sort of like an extended epilogue. The entire thing is kind of quiet and hushed for the most part. And basically, Ives says that he's trying to, in a fairly abstract way, sum up what Thoreau was writing about, similar to the first movement, Emerson. But then he kind of gives a caveat and says, but if there is a program, here it is, and he gives a pretty detailed program of what's happening. So long story short, it opens at kind of before dawn, and there's mist on Walden Pond, you'll hear it, and nothing much is happening for a while. It's foggy, misty, and finally a sort of clear idea takes shape. And that's Thoreau basically sort of defaulting to his wiring that we all have from living in society, that I should go do something, I need to accomplish something. And so he starts kind of walking around, not sure what he's going to do, but you hear the music sort of picking up. And then nature sort of interrupts and thwarts his, you know, his plans. If this happens a few times, and then finally he realizes that this is not what the day has in store for him. So he gives in, and Ives describes this kind of slow, monotonous rhythm of nature. And you hear that, comes in a few minutes in. Nature's slower rhythm, urging him to do less. And then there's a few other things that happen. You hear some sounds from Concord kind of across the hills. There's a church bell and a train and some different things. And finally, towards the end, it's dark again, and Thoreau is playing his flute over Walden Pond. And there's a version of this where you can have an actual flutist offstage playing the flute part. I will be playing the flute part. And then it closes with more of the sort of mist and fog, but at the very end there's one more Beethoven's fifth quote, but instead of going down like we're used to, it stays on the same note and has this sort of like disappearing into infinity